C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
This is an interview, everybody, Bryan Nehman, the audience, I've been looking forward to since the beginning of the school year, because I know that the guest joining us in studio right now, everyone, Ben Shifrin, the head of school at Jemicy School, loves teaching, loves the fact that kids want to learn, and has, I believe, Bryan, at least a little nugget of what we can be start doing right now to help kids that we are watching struggling. Ben Shifrin, good morning to you, my friend.
Great to have you here.
Oh, I'm thrilled to be back and also to be in person. You know, this school year, I think for many educators for a long time, has begun to feel normal again, like we're returning to some sense of normalcy. And coming in the studio today, I got a little pang, like,
me too.
Wow, I'm not doing it virtually. Me you know, too. We're here, and I get to meet Bryan in person. So,
I hope I didn't disappoint. You know,
not at all, Bryan.
Well, he doesn't disappoint, even though he's self-effacing. But let me ask you this, though, Ben Shifrin. Let's start at the very beginning. You come in today, and we know that the nation's report card, the National Assessment Educational Progress Report, has come out. And not just Maryland, but all states are suffering. And, of course, the pandemic only escalated, as we talked about off-air, what was happening before the pandemic. Ben Shifrin, you are working with the State Board of Education. What should we start doing right now to help our kids who are struggling, particularly academically? We'll get to the social part in a moment.
And I'm glad you mentioned the social, because it's a two-prong approach. One is we need to go back to basics. We forget that a year's time in a child's life is not like an adult. It's a long period of time, and a lot of growth as the brain is developing takes place. So the learning loss that many of these students had, not going to school or being virtual, is enormous and is going to take a while to catch up. We shouldn't be waiting for test scores. These test scores were not a surprise.
I'm talking about the MCAP, the state of education is waiting for these scores.
I mean, these scores were not a surprise. Any educator could have predicted this. What frustrates me is we're not doing anything about it now. Elementary school principals should put the day aside and revamp the day and focus their day on three main areas. Intensify reading instruction, correctly using structured literacy, not just whole language approach. Mathematics, begin to not just teach rote mathematics, but understanding of mathematics and writing. And of course, spelling and all of that in between. And then balance the day with things kids like to do, like the arts, so that they get to interact.
Some expression,
because remember that social piece our children have lost is also critical. You know, kids haven't played at recess. You know, I know when we watched last year first graders coming into Jemicy who had not really had virtual kindergarten, we had to give them kindergarten. I mean, they didn't know how to sit in a seat. They didn't know how to get into line. I mean, they achieved that.
Right.
But I don't think educators or the people making decisions realize how severe this is. Mm. And what I'm really waiting for is, I hope it comes out soon, how our counterparts in Europe did, who missed school. Is their gap as severe?
Right.
Because I believe their instruction was a lot better. I mean, that's just my gut from my travels overseas. They did a lot more for kids than we did here. And parents, you need to stand up now. This is a critical point in our country. We need to educate our kids. They're not reading, they're not succeeding, and we're not teaching them one very basic skill, which comes with learning to read, and that's how to think.
Mm.
And I believe till this day, and I believe most people believe, if we really taught our inner city kids to read and write and compete, we wouldn't have the violence we've had. Mm-hmm. What we're doing is we're putting Band-Aids on things instead of going to the root cause.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope if the governor does become Wes Moore, where he says a chance for everybody, I'd love 10 minutes with him to sit down and just say, this is what we need to be doing in the schools. This is how we need to be training our teachers. You know, we know how to teach reading. Let's just put the politics aside and get these kids reading. We spend more money than any country in the world in education. Mm-hmm. and we're so far behind ending industrialized nation, and our parents need to stand up.
But the answer is always more money. So Ben, and this is a bigger picture than just obviously the pandemic. Why is politics even involved in education if we know how to teach kids how to read? Well, shouldn't that be the goal? Shouldn't that be pretty easy to figure out?
Very easy to me. I mean, I don't want to point fingers, but I think the teachers' unions had something to do with it.
Yeah.
I look at the big institutions, the bureaucracies we created, instead of, if I were in charge, and I don't want to be in charge. Let me just say that.
I might adopt you as the czar of education.
What I would do is dismantle North Avenue and give blocks of money to the inner city schools so principals can develop the programs in their communities that they need. Mm. And what that would entail was teaching kids to read and write, bringing parents in who don't know how to read and write and work with their children. Mm-hmm. We could really turn this city around through education, not through more money. It's interesting. When they survey teachers in public school, the answer wasn't more money. They wanted better working conditions. Mm-hmm. They wanted professional development. They wanted to learn how, and we're not listening to
discipline in the classroom.
Discipline. I mean, these teachers need to be police people. I mean, this shouldn't be going on. I know we give free and appropriate education to everybody, but that doesn't mean at the expense of other children.
Or throwing desks at teachers. We've heard stories, Ben, about stabbing teachers with pencils, throwing desks at teachers.
I can seriously tell you, when we interview teachers from public school that do come to Jemicy to teach, they feel like they died and went to heaven. Mm. They said, you have no idea what it's like. To get up every day, to be a teacher, you need to be excited about your classroom. You need to be thinking about what's next. You always think about that child that's not getting it. I mean, I watch really good teachers. They shouldn't be worried about their life.
Yeah, right.
And then what does administration do? Nothing.
Nothing.
I mean, I view my job as a head of school to empower my teachers, not tell them, to empower our teachers to teach, not tell them how, and make sure they have what they need to teach. And when something isn't right and they need our support, we're there to support them. And that simple educational philosophy that we could be using all over the city. C4 and Brian, I look at what this city could be and what it was at one time. And the first thing we need to do is educate our citizens and our children. And when I was growing up, and we grew up about the same time,
yes,
we were taught what we can give back to our community, not what we take from our community. And somehow I wish we as a country, despite our differences, whether we're left or right, we can come together and say we need to build community.
Well, that ethic is missing tremendously. Ben Shifrin is here in studio, everybody, with Bryan Nehman and myself. He is the head of school at Jemicy School. You hear the energy and excitement that his children get. We talked with you, Ben, all throughout the pandemic. You would share with us how the kids were getting back into the classroom, all mitigation efforts, mask, all that stuff, and they were able to at least be in-person education. I think it's important with Kerwin starting right now. If Ben Shifrin is sitting with this new board that they created, Brian and I have talked about this new board with Kerwin, where should we start? We've got all this money coming in. Where should we start with Kerwin?
I think we start first in real teacher training. First, getting our teachers really ready to do what they need to do. And that means forming partnerships. First, teaching them the science of reading. Many of them don't know it. I mean, probably don't even know what I'm talking about if they're listening right now about the science of reading. Begin to educate them how kids learn, because we have all this neuroscience that's out there and no one's looking at it.
That's incredible to me.
I mean, all this money this country's invested of how kids learn, just not to read, but the environments they need to learn in and how the brain learns. And we're not even looking at it because, no offense, some of these tenured professors are so comfortable, they're not looking, and that's
why. They basically say, why?
Why? I mean, my job's secure. I'm teaching the way I need to teach. We are not preparing our teachers. That's number one. So I hope the first bit of Kerwin is we start really doing the appropriate professional development for our teachers in the science of reading and how the brain learns. And the big one that no one wants to talk about is executive functioning, or the executive skills kids need to survive in the world, okay? And that's a real critical piece that research says we just assume kids are going to learn and we don't teach them how to initiate, how to plan, how to organize, what to do if something gets in their way. I mean, this is life. This is how we live life every day, and we just assume kids are going to learn that. So that piece for teachers. I also think there needs to be strong accountability. In other words, if kids aren't making progress, why are we going down the same road? And I don't blame the teacher. I mean, if the teacher's doing what they need to do and the child isn't making progress, let's step back a second and
figure out what's wrong. Mm-hmm.
What's wrong? Not keep doing more of the same and looking to point fingers. So accountability needs to be a real critical part. And then real fair assessment and transparency with parents about their child. Learning to read is a complex process, okay? And we must remember all kids move at the same rate of that.
That's the biggest one.
And it has nothing to do with intelligence. That's the piece that educators was the aha moment. Because we associate if a child's struggling to read, they're not smart. And that's not true at all. And so if you have a child out there in the studio audience that's struggling to read, they can be very smart. It's about learning a code. And they may have trouble learning the code. And that's where we teach them. And those are the areas I would really initially focus on with real careful oversight and with real careful benchmarking.
We got to get you in there. We got to get you this Kerwin, folks.
Yeah, I know.
You know what? We're spending all this money that, honestly, I think we have lots that we could redirect to spend, okay? I am all for paying teachers. Listen, I wish I could pay my teachers what public school teachers get. And I say that with all the heart, but I have to charge my parents a $70,000 tuition. But when you think the students of Maryland, or Baltimore, get $18,000 per 17 in that range.
And what they get back.
And the administrative cost is almost 50%. Well, if I presented a budget to my board where my administrative costs were 50%, I wouldn't have a job.
Yep.
So that's what I would do, C4.
Let me ask you this, because we've been trying to figure out you brought up, hey, let's figure out how they did in Europe versus how they did here. But Jemicy was open a lot earlier than the public schools, right? And my son went to a private school, and he got into school before my other two sons were in public school. How do you think your kids are doing compared to public school kids? Can you have a comparison? I mean, is there a way to fairly assess that at this point?
I think it would be unfair to, because I don't have scientific data to say, but what I will tell you is our kids are happy, our kids are engaged, our kids look forward to getting up every day and going to school. They had the social interaction that was necessary for them to grow socially. And when we benchmark them, they are making the progress we expect them to make.
Okay.
So I don't think for the kids that came to Jemicy who were in person, now we had some kids for medical reasons and we really let it up to the parent. Really, Bryan, that's a parental decision. That was not, school was open, but that's your job as a parent. The school's not here to tell you what to do. I mean, we're providing
How about
you.
That?
Isn't that something? Isn't that different concept?
Okay, this is what we're providing. You choose whether you want it or not. But the bottom line was that the kids that really came to school, and even the virtual kids, because our teachers connected with them and they were part of the class, we're not seeing huge gaps.
Okay.
Are we seeing a little? I'm not going to lie. Yeah. But nothing that we haven't already, I think, remediated by this point.
Let me ask you this, because time always flies when you're on board, and everybody says, why can't you let them stay for 2 hours when they hear you talk? You guys actually have to run your school as well, Ben Shifrin of Jemicy School. As we're concluding our conversation with you, how can we get the passion that you bring and ignite that in particularly the teachers? Because a lot of teachers come in with passion, and they get crushed by the administration. How can we reignite that?
You know, it really starts from the top down in every school. You know, when the head of school believes in the mission of what they're doing, but I believe, unfortunately, the problem is even the principals in these schools are being so burdened with test scores and all this bureaucracy that they can't bring their creativity and their thought. That's why I said giving these schools blocks of money to create what they need in their communities, to make the schools a safe community center for the community is what we need to do. That and all the other stuff we want to get done in Baltimore. But until we empower principals and not tell them how to do their job, just like I empower our teachers, or I don't, my administrative team empowers my teachers. We don't tell them how to teach. We empower them to teach. Well, you know what? You're absolutely right. Just like teachers who start, they're ecstatic and in public ed,
so
in 2 years, they're done. Just like the kid that leaves in first grade is so excited to carry that book back and go to first grade, we wipe that smile off their face by third grade. So I think there are things, if we're serious about education, and if Governor, if Westmore becomes governor, I hope he'll just take 10 minutes to talk to us.
Because I'm lobbying for you. I just want you to know I'll be lobbying for you to get in there. But Ben Shifrin, once again, I can't thank you enough for just once again giving us a little light. Like, how can we get through this? A little light. Thank you so much, Ben Shifrin.
No, and thank you both for keeping education in the forefront.
You are a Maryland treasure. Honestly, and I hope people who are in power who listen to this hear it. Because I know that there are a ton of parents out there who feel it.
Well, their administrators
on
listening
a daily basis.
Yes.
And this education thing is a massive problem, and it needs to be addressed. It needs to be addressed quickly.
God bless you.
Else we're not going to have a country. Thank you.